I lived next to this one kid who always had bandages wrapped around their whole head, even covering their face. I remember his name was Wilbert, a 12-year-old boy who never left his house. He sometimes looked out of his bedroom window on the top floor at all the other kids who would play outside, while Wilbert sat and watched. I remember his window had a metal bar on them, so there was no way he could climb out of his bedroom windows. We sometimes communicated to each other by writing to each other on a piece of paper, since Wilbert couldn't hear me because the window was locked. Wilbert only does it when his parents aren't around, since they're weird. His mother and father were one of those parents who were insanely crazy about science and chemistry. According to Wilbert, they would stay in their basement and work all day and night, except at the time when they had to give Wilbert some food daily. Now, they're not treating him like an animal. His parents were just very busy. They told Wilbert that he shouldn't go outside to make contact with anybody until his face got better. He told me that he accidentally slipped on one of his parents' chemicals and fell face first, ruining his appearance, and his parents feared that he would be made fun of by the other kids in the neighborhood. I remember one time a couple of older kids were throwing rocks and pebbles at his window, laughing and pointing at Wilbert as he looked down at them. He told me they did it a few times, but he's used to it. But to me, he's a great guy, and still is today. I have never been inside his house, but he showed me some cool stuff he collected, like comic books. He has loads of them, Marvel, DC, and other non-superhero comics. He was a huge superhero fan. He even said that he felt like a superhero, a normal human being who became affected by dangerous chemicals and then became a powerful superhero. He once wrote on a piece of paper and had it put up his window as he pretended to be a superhero. I had a collection of action figures and video games that amazed Wilbert. He told me that he never played a single video game in his life, which was quite sad. He also told me that his babysitter took them away from him before he could play them, and burnt them in front of him. Wilbert had a mean babysitter named Miss Fritz Gerald, a tall, mean lady who never liked kids at all. This started before his face became messed up, he told me. She was basically every kid's nightmare. Of all the things I heard she has done, Miss Fritz Gerald had babysitted many kids before, and trust me, it was not pretty. Wilbert told me that the last kid she babysat, a 4-year-old girl, she made her throw 7 hours of hell. Wilbert said that Miss Physical starved her and surrounded her bed with a few bear traps. And the worst thing that happened, their parents didn't know about her deed. She will lie to them just to get paid. All those things I heard. She is a foul, cruel woman with no soul at all. And now she had to babysit this poor guy. Wilbert was old enough to make his own decisions, except for some, but his parents apparently hired an evil witch. The parents had to go to Texas to a scientist convention, so Wilbert was left alone with them, with her. One time, I was writing about her to show him, but then I saw Miss Fritzegold forcefully pull him away from the window, and that was the rest of my day without talking to him. The next day, I looked through the window to see Wilbert. I saw someone lying down on his bed. Looking at the person's rapid head, I banged my fist on the window, trying to get Wilbert's attention. He slowly sat up on his bed, wiped away tears from his eyes. He seemed to be crying, which gave me a thought. I had a worried look on my face as I saw bruises all over his arms and legs, a fairly dark tone of purple. He went to write something down on a piece of paper. Then as Wilbert finished writing, he went up to the window and pressed a note on the glass. What he wrote had terrified me. The whole situation still burnt in the back of my mind. Something I knew I would never forget. He wrote, "Help me." What made it worse was that the handwriting was scribbled on the paper and was almost illegible, unreadable. Wilbert kept banging on the window with his other hand. Then suddenly, I saw someone else run into the bedroom next to him. It was her. You know who. She had something in both of her big, chubby hands. In one hand was a lemon, and in the other was a pair of scissors. What Miss Fritzegold did terrified me even more. Miss Fritzegold ran up to Wilbert, grabbed his head, holding it still. I saw him screaming in pain and fear, so I knew I had to do something. At the time, I couldn't stop watching. She used the scissors to cut open the bandages and unwrapped them off his head and threw them to the side. What I saw almost made me vomit, something that sickened me. I was utterly shocked at looking at Wilbur's real face, a deformed face. His whole head was completely covered by bandages, but what was underneath I knew the purpose to. I saw his face, almost melted off, showing dark red layers underneath. I could only imagine his face looking like melted cheese on a cheeseburger. Wilbert's whole face, even one of his eyeballs, was burnt a bit. The chemicals had messed him up badly. Miss Fritzegel sliced the lemon in half with the scissors, pinning Wilbert down on his bed. Then she threw the scissors to the side, next to the bandages, and held his head still with one hand. With the other hand, she squeezed the lemon onto Wilbur's head, into his eyes, into the red layer of his face. The painful expression on his face, his loud muffled screams, his face stinging from the acid of the lemon juice. She used the other lemon to squeeze onto his face again, torturing Wilbert with extreme pain. I decided to bang my fist on the window, which was a bad idea. Miss Fritzegel looked over to the bedroom window, right at me. I jumped back. She noticed me. She ran back out of the bedroom, shoving Wilbert down as he screamed in pain and agony. I knew what she was going to do, so I ran to my bedroom and ran downstairs. I ran out of my bedroom and ran downstairs. The good thing about the situation was that my parents didn't know about Wilbert and the fact that they were at work for a little while. I locked the front door, hoping that Miss Fritzegold wouldn't burst into my house. I looked around for the house phone, but as I was, a loud banging rang my ears. I looked behind myself at the door, noticing her red, sweaty face as her curly blonde hair. By the look in her eyes, I knew there was going to be some trouble. She kept banging at the door, nearly screaming her head off. As I looked around for the phone, I finally spotted it next to the couch on the coffee table. I ran towards it, dialed 911, and the sound of Miss Fritzgerald's threatening screams were heard from the outside. Waiting for a few rings, I finally heard the operator's voice, the usual greeting from 911 operator. I started explaining the whole situation from beginning to end as quickly and clearly as possible. They told me to wait patiently as the police would arrive at my house soon. I took a few minutes for the police to arrive at my house. Not only did they arrive, but my parents arrived earlier from work as well. Apparently, they got a call from the police explaining my situation and decided to come home. My parents were extremely worried and frightened, and they asked me more questions about it than the police did. I had to explain everything, from being friends with Wilbert, to how his parents left him with an abusive babysitter, to what she tried to do. But after an hour later, a police officer came to me. He had something he wanted to tell me about the horrible atrocities that took place next door, the truth about the babysitter, the parents, and Wilbert. It was truly shocking. Based on the evidence they found, Wilbert's parents weren't actually his parents at all. They adopted Wilbert from an orphanage that's out of town, only to perform an experiment on him. It was the reason why they moved to Texas, to hide. The babysitter, Miss Fritzgerald, was part of the experiment too. In fact, Wilbert wasn't the first kid to get adopted by the scientists. They had done illegal experiments on these orphans, and it was to find out how much pain a child could take before death. Based on the cause of death and the age of the child, 38 children between the ages of 2 and 13 were reported missing, and Wilbert was one of them. There were secret cameras on the outside and the inside of the house. Right now, they arrested Miss Fritzgerald for child cruelty and the deaths of many children, and are now on the case to find the two scientists. All of that, and I was friends with someone who would have been killed if I hadn't called the police. Apparently, Wilbert also tried to lie about almost everything he told me. He was trying to protect himself. He was sent to a new trusted family, a married couple, who lived out of town. Since then, I never heard of him again. Until now. 20 years later, I went to a bar to get myself a few drinks by myself when a man approached me. "Remember me," he said. That familiar man smiling at me. I smiled back, realizing how long it had been since I last seen Wilbert. In fact, he looks like a nice, honest man now, without his bandages. He was a brown-haired man with sky blue eyes. He almost looked like a complete stranger. And after that, we talked and drank a few glasses, finally speaking to each other in person. Wilbert and I knew that nobody would try to keep us apart. The scientists and the babysitter are probably locked away right now. After all, I couldn't stop thinking about the fact that this man would have been killed if I hadn't saved his life.